So good afternoon. The topic of this talk is pseudo-random functions and pseudo-random permutations. So recall that we spoke about one-way functions and arcward predicates, and also about pseudo-random generators. So this is the third talk, and then we're going to have another talk for the day. Bye, Benny. Let's see, skip these slides. So what are these pseudo-random functions? So we've seen what we call a pseudo-random generator or pseudo-random object. This is a small set of objects, right, which look like a much larger set of objects. Specifically, it was a set of, you know, say 2 to the n strings, which is indistinguishable from a set of 2 to the n plus 1 strings. Right? If you get a random element from this set, you cannot distinguish between a random element from the largest set, from uniform string. Now, we want to take this miracle a step further. We want to create a small set of objects, where here I'm going to speak about efficient function family. And I want them to be indistinguishable from the all function family, or from the random function family, which is a huge set of objects. Think about, in this case, these are strings. The description of element here is n bits, and the description of the element here is n plus 1 bits. So, you know, I couldn't speak about the output of this pseudo-random generator. They look the same, but at least they are the same length. Now, and we're going to define it soon, we want to speak the set in consideration are efficient function family and random function family. The problem is that random function family is a huge family of sets. And efficient function family is a tiny family of sets. So even to say, how can you distinguish, even to describe one of these elements of the function family takes much, much longer than efficient function family. So how can, you know, it's very easy to distinguish, right? You see an elephant, you know it's an elephant. You'd never think it's a mouse. So the idea is going to be that we're going to put two of them in the same box. And therefore, and now you can only ask questions, either the mouse or the elephant, and hopefully you cannot distinguish between them. Okay? So let me be more formal. So again, we're going to speak about function families. So I start to describe what is a random function family. What is the function, the family of all random functions? For integer n and k, the function family pi n k is a set of all functions from string of length n to string of length k. Okay? And specifically going to mainly focus about this function family, which is all length reserving functions. All functions from n bits to n bits. Okay? And in a sense, when you choose a random function from this family, you get many, many random bits. Okay? If you think about a truth table of a random function, it's simply a 2 to the n times n bits random strings. And what it means is a family, and what is a function, you are given access. So if you think about the truth table of the function family, it's not only that it's a huge random string, you're going to give an access to any random access to element of these strings. This is what it means as a function. You can query the function at any point in its truth table. Okay? So in a sense, it's a random access source of randomness. You're getting very, very long random strings, and you don't have to read it from straight from the beginning till it ends. You can ask what in the 2007 bits, or what is the bit over there, etc., etc. Okay? And it turns out to be a very, 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 if you could have random access to such a random member of a function, of the whole function family, you get Oracle access. You could query wherever you want a random function. you could do miracles. You could do many, many, many things. You could do very efficient protocol, very, very efficient implementation of cryptographic primitives. Benny is going to describe a few examples in the next talk, okay? So if you had access to such creature, a huge random string, you can ask whoever you like, it will be very, 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 very nice implications and applications. Unfortunately, there's no reason to believe that you can have access to such creature. In particular, as I mentioned, it takes very, very many bits to describe a random function of the all function family. How long does it take? Okay, again, you have the set of all functions from n bits to n bits. How long does it take to describe a single element? Well, you have to describe each of its outputs, right? There are 2 to the n different inputs. For each of them, you have to describe what is its output. So it takes 2 to the n times n bits to describe a random element or any element of this set. Okay, so this is a huge function family, such huge that it takes exponential number of bits to describe an element of this family. And again, if you think about the truth table of a random functions from this family, it's simply a very long random string, 2 to the n times n random bits. Okay? Again, I'm repeating, we think, it doesn't introduce what is a random what is the all function family from n bits to n bit, or sometimes called the random function family, with simply the all possible functions for n bit for n bit, which are very, if you could have access to a random element, it would be very useful. But unfortunately, you don't, specifically because only to describe such creature, it takes very, very long. Okay. So this is nice. In a sense, this is going to be what, in Benny's talk, we said random strings. Random bits are very useful, random strings are very useful resource. But sometimes we cannot have access to huge or very long random strings, and therefore, rather than using random strings, use pseudo random strings, right? So in our case, the ideal case in the case of this talk, the ideal case is going to be random functions, but we are not going to use them. Instead, we're going to use pseudo random functions. Okay. Previously, we've seen rather than random string, we use pseudo-random strings. Now, instead of random function, using pseudo-random function, let me try to define what is these pseudo-random functions. So first, what is, again, I'm going to speak about ensemble of function families, so it will be a bit formal. So ensemble of function family is a set of function families, okay? Okay, for every n, the function family is a set of function from, say, mn bits to ln bits, okay? So it's an infinite creature. Well, for every input length, for every n security parameter, it's a finite function family of functions, okay? Okay, and throughout, we're going to identify a function with their descriptions, okay? Function is simply the description of the function. Okay, and if you define this creature, can you speak about efficient function family? What are efficient function family? Functions, a function family that you can both sample a random element from it. Specifically, given n, there exists an algorithm that given n, output the description of a random function, of a random element or random function from the family fn, okay? You're given 70, you can choose a random family from the function F70. Okay. And secondly, you can efficiently evaluate this function. Specifically, there's an algorithm, polynomial time algorithm in both cases, that given a description of function F and given input X, simply compute F of X. Okay, so these are efficient function families. Okay. You can sample a random element from them, you can evaluate them efficiently, okay? Okay, so we've seen two kind of creatures. One are random functions, as I said, without explaining too much, but they are very useful creatures, but only to describe them takes exponential number of bits. In particular, random families, or the set of all functions, is not efficient, because Someone can explain why the set of all functions is not an efficient family? Yes, I mean, how can think about the sampling part? How can you sample an element in polynomial time, which only to describe him takes exponential number of bits? So you can never even write down the description of this element. Okay, so random family are, I mentioned, very useful random access resource of randomness, but not efficient. Where on the other hand, we have efficient function family. We can sample random element, you can evaluate them, everything efficiently, but they cannot be random, or almost by definition, right? The description is too small. So similarly to what happened when we're describing pseudo-random strings, now we can define what is pseudo-random function. So pseudo-random function is a set, is an efficient function family, as we said before. You can evaluate it and sample it efficiently. But still, it looks like a random function. But how can it look like a random function? As I said, only the description of a random function is huge, it's like the elephant there, where the description of a member of efficient family is tiny, is polynomial size. On the other, there's one creature with polynomial size description. On the other hand, there's a creature of exponential size description. It's very easy to distinguish between an elephant and a mouse, as we said. Correct, but maybe it is hard when you're given Oracle access to that. What do I mean? Consider the following two experiments. Think of an efficient algorithm, D, that is given random access or Oracle access to a random member of the efficient family. Okay? What does mean Oracle access? He can make queries, and in return, he's going to get back the answers. Okay? He doesn't see the description of the element, but he can make Oracle queries and get back the answers. Okay? Think about this experiment, or compare it to the case where the same algorithm gets Oracle access now not to a member of the efficient family, but for a truly random function. And now he can also make queries and get back the answer. He never sees the description of the function, because otherwise it would be very easy to distinguish. He can only make Oracle queries and get back the answer. And also, in both cases, he should output either 0 or 1. We said that efficient function family is pseudo-random, is pseudo-random function family. If no efficient algorithm can distinguish between the two cases with more than negligible probability, these two experiments are computationally distinguishable. Okay? Questions? Yes.
The efficiency in the definition is not of the complexity of the computation of the function, right?
But both. All for the function.
Because in the previous slide, you mentioned the algorithm that computes the function, it receives the efficiency.
Yes. Yes, but description of F is also polynomial size. Good question. But the question is, the evaluation algorithm is not efficient because part of its input is the description of F. But this requirement that asking that the sampling time is polynomial time, in particular, it says that the description size of the efficient function family is also polynomial size. And therefore, it follows that this function is also you can evaluate in polynomial time in n. Okay. But again, we have efficient function family is pseudo-random if it is indistinguishable or computationally distinguishable from a truly random function. And again, say it again, these two creatures are very, very different. So different that it takes, say, 2n bits to describe one of them and 2 to the n bits to describe the others. So if you could see all the truth table of these two functions, it was very, very easy to distinguish. But in our experiment, we speak about polynomial type distinguishing, in particular, how many number of queries they can make, polynomial many of them, and they get back the answers. At least syntactically, the two experiments look the same. There's polynomial number of queries and polynomial number of answers in both cases. Okay, so we have a chance to create such creature. Okay. As I said, this is why Oracle aided. This is actually the only definition to make sense, because again, it's very easy to distinguish between huge object to small object, unless you are restricted in the way you access them. I claim that if you only care about pseudo-random function with short input length, logarithmic and input length, then you can easily construct them with no assumption. Okay? They simply exist information theoretically. Anyone has a suggestion? How long it takes to describe a truly random function of input of length 2? 1 bit. 1 bit pseudo random function. Okay? How long does it take? What is the size of its truth table? 2n, right? And if you speak about log bit input random function, its truth table is simply n squared. Or polynomial, if it's order of log n, it's polynomial in n. So what will be the pseudo random function with input of length log n? The truly random function. Okay? You can simply efficiently sample a truly random function. How could you sample it? You choose a random string of the right length, say this is the truth table of the pseudo random function, and by definition, it is the same creature as the truly random function. So, truly random functions are indistinguishable from truly random function. Right? So, again, if you only care about pseudo-random function of short input length, they exist information theoretically because the truly random function, according to this definition, is also pseudo-random function. Okay. Okay. So this is not too interesting. On the other hand, PRF of super logarithmic input length, which is the only interesting case when you think about application, imply PRGs. Okay, and this is part of your homework, if anyone wants to do them. So this is a good start. Okay, it's not hard to show, though. Okay, so we have this gap. Pseudo-random functions of short input length exist information theoretically. If you slightly increase the input length, suddenly they imply pseudo-random generators. Okay, and therefore apply one F function, and therefore that P is not equal to NP, etc., etc. So you need assumption, they not exist information theoretically. Okay. And why do we need this creature? Okay? Why do we need these pseudo-random functions? So basically, I mentioned, and again, it's going to be much clearer after Benny's talk, that pseudo-random, if you have access to random function, you could do it effectively, say, in protocols, or you want to implement primitives, etc., encryption schemes. It would be very, very useful resource. But you cannot implement them, because only to describe this random function takes very long. So what do? You create a scheme, say, encryption scheme, assuming you have access to truly random function. And then you use it with pseudo-random function. And because the pseudo-random function is indistinguishable from the truly random function, if the scheme was secure when you assume you have access to truly random function, the scheme is going to remain secure when you have access to pseudo-random function. Okay? Good. So we have this very nice creature, okay, that going to allow us to do many things. And the question, do such creatures exist? Does there exist a pseudo-random function family? And the answer is with long input length, right? short input left aside exist trivially? And the answer is? We don't know, right? This is a good answer. And the second answer is? We don't know. Again?
It exists if we have one-way function.
Again. It exists if we have one-way function. Okay, and taking continue the analog of Benny. So if Benny, if one-way function is small hill, a pseudo-random generator is a big mountain, so pseudo-random functions is a big mountain where you have cable from your, you go out of your of the stairs of your apartment, and you have cable car straight to the very peak of the mountain. Okay? Not only that it's a great creature, it's also very useful. Let me use additional stupid analog. Think that your friend gives you a hard disk with all the movie you ever wanted to see. Okay? Never mind how did he get this hard disk, but he gives you the hard disk, okay? You're very happy, it's a great resource, but unfortunately, if you want to see the 15 movie, every time you have to see all the movies before you see the 15 one, okay? So it's a great resource, but it's not so accessible, right? So this is in a sense pseudo-random generator. It's a great resource of pseudo-randomness, but every time you want to access it, you have to generate all the bits. Till you get to the, say, one to the 1,000 bit, you have to generate all the bits before that. Pseudo-random function is similar, in a sense you can think about the pseudo-random generator that generates, and I'm going to elaborate it more, you can think about, in a sense, the pseudo-random generator that generates, it's not really generates, a huge pseudo-random string, exponential size pseudo-random string, but if you like to access to the ith random bit, you can access it directly in logarithmic time, and you don't have to generate all the bits before that. Okay, so this is the maybe good analog. Okay, good. So now, so we define pseudo-random function. And now we want to create them for pseudo-random generator, for pseudo-random from one-way function. Actually, we're going to create them or create from pseudo-random generators or length doubling pseudo-random generators. But as we know, after the second talk, pseudo-random generator and in particular length doubling pseudo-random generator, say from n bits to 2n bits, exist if one-way function exists. So the task is end. You are given a present a length doubling pseudo-random generator. You want to create an efficient family of pseudo-random functions. Okay? Good. So how do you do that? Okay? Again, you have a pseudo-random generator, you want to create a pseudo-random function family. Let's start with a very modest task. Assume you want to create a one-bit inputless pseudo-random function family. Okay? Again, we said it's not interesting, the existing information theoretically, but still, let's consider this task. And assume you are given a pseudo-random generator from n bits to 2n bits. Okay? So, you're going to, the function fs, okay, the function in this family are going to be indexed by string, okay. The function fs from 1-bit input to n-bit input is defined as following, as follows, fs of 0 is simply the first n bits of the output of pseudo-random generator on what? On s, okay. So again, the description of the function is S. In order to evaluate it on the bit zero, you compute G of S and output the first n bit. Where Fs of one, you compute the pseudo-random generator again on S, but now you don't output the first n bit, but rather the second block of n bits. From the n plus 1 bits to, this will be plus 1 to the 2n bits. Okay, again? We have g goes from n bits to 2n bits. So the function fs, okay, this is simply the description of the function, compute g of s, and if its input is 0, its output this part, this is fs of 0, and this is fs of 1. Okay? Clearly, it is an efficient function family. Why is it an efficient function family? How do you choose a random element of this family? What do you do? You sample s. You sample a random s. You sample a random string of n bits. Clearly, sampling random string of n bits, assuming that you can flip random coin, can be done in even linear time, right? Okay, so sampling random element of this family is simply choosing a random string of length n. How do you evaluate this function? Here, it's written there, right? You compute g of s, which is in polynomial time, since g is a pseudo-random generator, and then you either output the first bit or the second bit. This is first half or the second half, according to your input. Okay, so it's clearly an efficient function family, okay? Both efficiently samplable and efficiently computable. And the claim is that if g is a PRG, then this function family is pseudo-random function. Okay? Anyone? Okay, again, we created a very modest task, a one-bit input pseudo-random function family. Totally useless, but still. So what is the truth table of a random element of this function, of length n? What is the truth table of this, such member?
The output of g.
So truth table of a random element of f is simply g u n. Because what is the truth table? It says what does the function output on the first on the first input, which is 0, what does the function output to the second input, which is 1? Here it outputs the first half of the output of g, here the second half of the output of g. So the truth table of a random element of this function family is g of u n, right? A random output of a pseudo-random generator. What is the truth table of a truly random function over 1 bit to n bits? What is the truth table of such function? Again, you choose a random function that maps 1 bit input to n bit output. First, right? So it's of the same length, right? The function is, right? It has two parts. What does the function output on 0? What does the function output of 1? On one. But what are random function output on 0? Uniform string. And what does random function output on 1? 2 independently chosen random strings, sorry. So if one could distinguish between a random function from the efficient function from f and a truly random function, in particular, it distinguishes between what? Between this truth table. Okay, what can this distinguisher can do? You can query the function of the first input on the second input. Okay, and then do some calculation. But if you can distinguish between the two cases, it implies that it can distinguish between what? The output of g of a uniform input and a truly random thing, a string of length 2n. But it cannot do that. Why? Because g is assumed to be a pseudo-random generator, right? So if g is assumed to be a pseudo-random generator, no one can distinguish between g of a random string and a truly random string of length 2n. Okay, good. So we created a one input, a bit input length pseudo-random function family. As I said, it's not that exciting, because you can actually sample the truly random function for one bit, because it's, you know, it discretizes only double the description size of the pseudo-random function. But still, it's a good start, okay? We went from description less n, it takes n bits to describe a member of this family, to 2n bits where it takes to describe a truly random function. Okay? And then he said, sometimes the hard part is to go from n to 2n, and then everything else is rather easy. It's not the case here. Here it's going to suffer, we're going to suffer more. And it naturally extends to input of length log n. Anyone can explain why? If we assume we want to do essentially the same, but now not from one bit input, but for 7-bit input, or log n bit input, what would you do? You stretch. So rather than thinking of a pseudorandom generator from n bits to n bits, you would think of a pseudorandom generator from n bits to poly n bits, right? So now you do exactly the same thing. The description of the function is simply s, the seed to the pseudorandom generator. And now when someone asks you what is the output of the function on the ith output, you would take the ith part, you split them into blocks of length n, and now you take the ith part, or f s of x, is simply the x part of the output of the pseudorandom generator. Again, rather than if it was one bit, you use a pseudorandom generator from n bits to 2n bits. If it's log n bit, use a pseudorandom generator from n bits to poly n of bits, okay? Or n square bits. Great. So we know to do log n bits. But as I said, this, to do that, we can do it information theoretically. On the other hand, what happens if you try to do it for longer input? Okay, so first, this function, you can still efficiently sample from this function family, right? Because the description size of a member of the family is going to be n bits. But what's going to be the problem? What is going to be inefficient? Computing it. Because only to compute g, you know, if you use super logarithmic number of bits input, you need to use g that stretch n bits to super polynomial number of bits. And you have to compute it all, say, in order to answer the last input. But it means you have to write down a super polynomial number of bits, which cannot be done in polynomial time, right? So this kind of solution seems to be inherently limited to logarithmic input length, which is a pity because we knew how to do it before. So it seems we got nothing from all this whole argument. And the problem was that in order to answer the ith input, we need to construct all the truth table of the function. Okay, this is the way we describe it. We first create the truth table of the function, which is simply the output of the pseudorandom generator on S. And if the function is a super polynomial truth table, then you are dead, because you cannot compute even a truth table. And you need to compute a truth table according to this definition. So the construction we're going to see soon by Goldreich, Goldwasser, and Micali follow this intuition, essentially, but you're going to use G. Again, the seed of the G is going to be the same as the description of the function family, but you're going to construct the truth table of the function in a more clever way, such that if you only need to answer this part of the output of the truth table, we don't have to compute the whole truth table. Because if you try to give solutions that compute the whole truth table of the family of the function, we cannot handle long inputs. Okay? So this is the one maybe bullet to take from these slides. So pseudo-random, to create a pseudo-random function, we need to create a truth table for functions that look pseudo-random. Okay? So this is a good start, but instead we need to create this truth table in an efficient way. We need to create it without that we can access part of this truth table without the need to compute the whole truth table. Okay? You only want to see the 17th movie, and you don't want to create to see the whole movie before that. Movies before that. Good. So now I'm going to describe you the construction. How do you construct, again, for pseudo-random generator with left doubling, how do you construct a pseudo-random a function family? So this is a formal definition. Let me give the more pictorial one, which is easy to see, to follow. So again, we are starting with G. We can think of a pseudo-random generator with length doubling. And the description of the function family is going to be a seed for this generator. N bits input seed for this generator. And similarly, when you, if this is G of zero on the input is simply the left-hand part of the output, the N bits, which are the left-hand part of the output of G, and G1 is the right-hand side part of the output of G. Okay? So this is similar to what we did in the previous slide. And now comes the tricky part. How do you define fs of x, where x is a k-bit input? Okay? So let me give you the formal definition, and then I'm going to walk you through in the tree. It's going to be easier to follow. So basically, you compute fs of the first k minus 1 bits of the input. It's a recursive definition. And then you feed it as input to G. And now you look at the last bit of the input you didn't look before. If it's zero, you take the left hand side part of the output of G. And if it's one, you take the right hand side out of G. So this is very confusing, this recursive definition. Let me give you an alternative approach or point of view of how to think about this computation. So you're starting with a tree. You think that you are walking on a tree where the seed is labeled with S. S is the description of the S is the description of the function family member, of the member that you want to compute, of the function that you want to compute on X. So this is the tree evaluation of fs. Now you look at the first bit of the input, either at 0 or 1. What do you do with this bit? First, you compute g on this s. You compute g of s. If this bit is 0, you take the left-hand side of the output, you take this part of the output, and go to the tree whose root is labeled by the left-hand side of the output. If the first bit of the output is 1, you continue to the tree whose root is the right-hand side of the output. Okay? Again, you processed the first bit of the output. It tells you whether you go left to the tree whose root is the left-hand side of the output of G, or you go right to the tree whose root is the right-hand side output of 3. And then you continue. Okay? Now you read the second input. You either go here or you go here. Every time you evaluate the pseudo-random generator on the root, and then you either go to the tree whose label is the left-hand side of the pseudo-random generator, or you go to the tree whose root is labeled with the right-hand side of the pseudo-random generator. Let me give you an additional example, because still it's maybe the most confusing things about this whole construction. So you want to compute fs of 0, 0, 1. Okay? So first, again, you start with s, you compute g0 of s. What is g0 of s? You compute g of s, and you took the left-hand side. Why do you compute that? Because the first input of a bit of the input is 0, right? This is this 0, so you compute g0 of s. Namely, you went there. Now, the second bit of the input is zero. So you compute again G0 of S. Namely, went to this node. Okay? Now come the surprise. The third bit of the input is 1. So now we compute G1 of what you computed till now, which is G1 of G0 of G0 of S. And what do you do with that? You output it. Okay? After you compute the label of the leaf, after you fully you read the all input, the all bits of the input, you have given a label of the tree of a leaf. You simply output it as the output of the function over the input. Okay. Saying it completely differently, you can think about evaluate or computing this all tree, which only depends on S. There's no input involved. And now, when you get the input X, you simply output the label of the leaf of the X of the of the X of an X leaf. You look at X, you read X. You look, say X is 70. You look at the 70 leaf, and output is label. Okay. That's the question. If k is n, what is the size of this tree? If k is n, what is the size of this tree? What is the depth of this tree? N. If k is n, the depth of the tree is n. This is a binary tree, so how many leaves it has? 2 to the n, right? 2 to the n, and what is the label, the what is the size of the label of each leaf? N, right? So what is this, if you think about it, what is written there? The truth table of FS, right? This is simply the truth table of S of S. If you look about only about the leaves, you see the truth table of S, which is, because F, say if its input length is N, there's no way to avoid it. The truth table is huge. It might be that everything is the same. All the leaves have the same label, but the truth table is huge, okay? Okay, so this is the way the GGM construction or the GGM construction is defined. Again, you start with the pseudo-random generator, and it defines you for any input length, actually, or specifically think about input of length N, it describes your function, an efficient function family. It's actually not only working for input length N, it can work for any input length that you like. Okay? Note that even though the truth table of the function is huge, as it should be, computing it is very simple. Why? Because how many operations it takes to compute g of input of length k? K invocation of pseudo-random generator. So if k is n and pseudo-random generator is efficient, it takes polynomial time. Okay? So this function is efficient because g is efficient, but because we didn't compute the whole truth table of the function, but rather we went directly to the leaf we are interested in. So this is a good start. And the very fundamental theorem of Goldreich and Michali is that if G is a pseudo-random generator, then F is a pseudo-random function family. Okay? That's a note. This theorem exists before we knew how to construct pseudo-random generator from one function. Okay? We assume we have a pseudo-random generator, or left double pseudo-random generator, and showed how to create a pseudo-random function family out of it. But given the knowledge that one function, a function implies the existence of pseudo-random generator, and in particular the existence of length doubling pseudo-random generator, we have this amazing result that from one-way function, simply assuming that exists one-way function, there exists efficient family of pseudo-random functions. Okay? Yes.
possible to construct here every step you need to double the number of bits. Is there a construction where it's enough to add a constant number of bits somehow at each step? Something, you know, just a little bit more efficient.
So the question is, can we do something better? Something better. And this is a good question. And I'm not sure that the construction you suggested does work. There are some trade-offs, but basically, this is a very important open question. To get a more efficient construction of pseudo-random function family from length doubling pseudo-random generator, or from pseudo-random generator, okay? We don't know that. More questions before we move to the proof? Is the construction clear? Because I think it's more complicated than proof to understand how to evaluate this function. Okay. So again, we want to prove that this is this function family, again, which is clearly efficient, sampling it only to sample random n-bit string, evaluating is very efficient as well, to prove that it's pseudo-random function family. How do we do that? Using the two tools that we know, right? Using reduction and hybrids. I mean, what is the two tools that we have in our hand? And specifically, we assume there exists an algorithm violating the pseudo-randomness of this function family, and use it to violate what? The pseudo-randomness of the PRG in end, right? So we start with an algorithm violating the hardness of pseudo-random function, and use it to violate the assumed hardness of the PRG. So, you know, as we did before, we fix some such probabilistic polynomial D and P such that D distinguishes between the cases that you have access to pseudo-random element of the function, which I indicate by Fn, and the case we get random oracle access to pseudo-random member of the whole function family, of random function, okay? Assuming that you have such creature, we want to construct D prime, we are going to construct D prime, that it does not directly distinguish between the pseudo-random generator and its and a uniform string, the output of pseudo-random generator and uniform string, but rather it distinguishes between N calls to the pseudo-random generator, or sorry, T calls to the pseudo-random generator, then T to N bits uniform strings. Okay? But what is T? T is a bound on the running time of D, okay? Know that if D runs in time at most T, how many oracle calls it makes at most? At most T, right? You cannot make more than T calls. Okay? So, but again, as we've seen before, if one can, since T is going to be polynomial because D runs in polynomial time, if one can distinguish between this random string and T output of pseudo-random generator, independent call of pseudo-random generator, it can distinguish between what? A single output of pseudo-random generator and a uniform string, which is a contradiction. Okay? So we assume we don't have to go further than that. If you prove that, we are done. Okay. Good. So now, okay, so instead of going to use hybrid, the hybrid is going to be more challenging and more delicate than the one we've seen before. Okay, but so let's see again. So this is the evaluation tree of the pseudo-random function. Okay, and now that you have. Now, think we're identifying functions with tree, okay? Simply, if you have a tree, if you want to evaluate the function of x, you simply take the x leaf, okay? So we, for the rest of the talk, you're going to identify functions with trees, okay? You get a tree, you can evaluate the function everywhere. Because in particular, the leaves, we view the leaves as the function as the truth table. But now, think about the following experiment. think about the set of all trees in which the first high levels of the tree are arbitrary, might contain any possible values, but then for further, if you want to fully evaluate the tree, say that all these parts is arbitrary, you continue like the GGM construction does. Namely, if you want to compute this value, you apply the pseudorandom generator on this label and take the left-hand side. Say it again. Think about some creature on which the first high level, I can allow any random value, any possible value, but from this i-th level on, I apply g, okay? It's some in-between creature between, it's some generalization of the tree that you said before, okay? So given such tree, we can define the function ht, which simply returns, view the leaves as the truth table of a function and repair the appropriate location, okay? Good. So now we have that. What is the function which is defined by all trees in T1? What is T1? T1 says, by definition, that I put any function, any value that I want here, but I continue by evaluating the GGM construction. Namely, to evaluate this label, I apply G, and they take either the left-hand side or the right-hand side, and then so on. Okay? So I put anything that I like in the root, but then follow like the GGM construction. I construct tree, I can figure out all possible tree I could construct it this way, and now I pick a random tree and view it as a function. Which function family is this? Is this tree? This is the GGM construction. It's simply Fn, right? Because what does it mean that any possible tree? It means that I allow any possible value here. So I pick random tree. This is simply random value, uniform value. And now I continue by applying G to go all the way down. So this is simply the GGM construction. View it differently, the root S is chosen uniform at random, but all these are pseudo-random value generated by applying G. Good. But what is HN? HN means that I pick all the tree, all possible trees. There's no DGM here. I choose all possible values to the leaves of the tree, in particular to the node of the trees of the tree, in particular to the leaves, and now answer according to them. Which function family is it? Right. This is simply the all function family. Why? Because in particular, the value of the leaves are two random strings. So now the function that induces this function truth table is a random string of this length to the time n bit, time n length. And therefore, this is simply the all function family, or the random function family. Nice. By our assumption, D can distinguish between these two hybrids. Either he gets, if he can distinguish with the case, he can distinguish with the case where he gets a random family from this set and a random function family, a random function from this set, right? Because we assume he distinguishes between the random functions or the all function family and F, right? The GGM family. And now by hybrid, okay, again, we need to know what to choose the level at random, etc., or to approximate it. D distinguishes between two neighborhood hybrids, right? What is a neighborhood hybrid in our case? In this case, the first three levels are chosen truly at random, and then you compute the rest of the levels, in particular the leaves, by applying the pseudorandom generator. And in this hybrid, the first four levels, truth table, it doesn't care about, it never sees the internal nodes, right? So you can forget about them. We have an algorithm that distinguishes between This pseudo-random string, what is written here, think about what this hybrid stands for. It stands for, let me start with this hybrid simpler. This is simply a uniform string, okay? This is the blue, it's simply a uniform string on length 2 to the 9 times n. But what this hybrid stands for, what this string stands for, it's simply 2 to the n minus 1 outputs of the pseudo-random generator. Again, I don't care what value were here, okay? I totally don't care that here it was written pseudo random string as well, and also here. I don't care. If you focus, because D only sees the truth table. And the truth table is either random string or 2 to the n minus 1 outputs of the pseudo random generator. So we're getting closer, okay? Again, we want to use D to distinguish between output of T calls to pseudo-random generator and random string of size 2 times 2 to the n, 2 to n. But we are not yet there. We got huge, the D can distinguish between many calls to the pseudo-random generator and very long string. But this is problematic, because it's very easy to distinguish between them. I claim that it's efficiently easy to distinguish between this string and this string, not using Oracle access, using arbitrary access. Anyone can tell me why? Right, because if this is the input length, its use is exponential to the n, you can simply invert g. Right? You can invert g, you have enough time to invert g, and then you can check whether this bit is in the output of g or not, or these two n bits. If these two n bits are in the output of g, you say 1, if not, you say 0. Okay? So it's very easy to distinguish between these huge strings. But now, we are missing something. What we are missing? The T, right. T not only distinguishing between these two huge strings, it distinguishes them using Oracle access, using T queries, T Oracle queries to the strings, right? And this is a crucial issue. Okay? So again, the solution is to focus on the part that D sees. He doesn't see the whole strings. He only see very, very small portion of them. And what are we going to do? We're going to effectively, we are going to get either the output of the pseudo-random generator, or truly random string, and we're going to effectively emulate D with Oracle access to this huge string, or D with Oracle access to this huge string. In case we get T uniform string, it's going to be this case. In case we get T pseudo-random string, it's going to be the left-hand side case. And therefore, we can distinguish between the pseudo-random generator strings and the uniform strings. Specifically, how do we do that? The easier thing is to see it by picture. So again, D prime is getting T strings. They are either uniform, each of them is 2n bits, or pseudo random. Again, each of them 2n bits, which is the output of the pseudo-random generator, or different inputs. Now, he starts emulating D. What this makes? D makes query. Right? D makes a query, the first query. What's going to put there? In the truth table. Think about D queries, make queries to the truth table of the function. Right? What are you going to put there? Y1. Okay? D makes a second query, you're going to put Y2, right? He gets strings. Every time D makes a query, he fills the right cell, only the cell that we care about. If D is never asking about this part, there's no reason for D prime to put any value there, right? Now, D makes a third query, again, Now come the tricky part. What happened when they make the fourth query, but it points to the same cell that you already put value there, right? Not the same location. You know, D probably does make the same query twice, but at the same cell. Previously, it was to the right-hand side of this two neighboring cell, which was covered by the same Y. Recall that these cells, or the truth table, is by the input, the value of each cell is n bits, where the value that D got is 2n bits. So he's filling them like, putting them like, every time covers two different location in truth table. So if D make the fourth queries, and he already covered it, he gives him back the same value as before. Okay? Well, this is good, because think what happened here. If D queries this value and this value, both were the same of the same call to the pseudorandom generator, right? They weren't independent. This creature is defined by making different calls to the less doubling pseudorandom generator. In particular, these two values are always output of a single call to the pseudorandom generator. And these two values are, again, always the value of a single call to the pseudorandom generator, and so on. So effectively, what if this would be pseudo-random strings? What this is? Effectively, this is as if he has access to this truth table. He doesn't know that there is no values here, right? Because these are the only value that he looks at. Where if these y's are taken are uniform, what this is? Effectively, as if his query this huge random string. Again, he doesn't know that I only put the random value where he look at. He never look outside of his queries, right? So effectively, we emulated D with Oracle access either to R or to P, either to the random string, huge random string, or to the pseudo-random string. Again, huge pseudo-random string. But we emulated efficiently. Because again, D only makes polynomial number of queries. So if D could distinguish between D with noticeable probability, D prime distinguishes between these two cases also with the same probability, actually. There's no loss here. And by what we showed, this is by our assumption, this is 1 over poly, and this is a contradiction to the pseudo-randomness of G. Okay, so I have you are going to late in 5 minutes more. I need like 10 minutes more of 15. Okay, let's be more optimistic. Okay, so we constructed pseudo-random function family from pseudo-random generators, and therefore from one function. It wasn't easy, but you did it in less than an hour. Now, we got ambitious. We want to do even something more. We want to construct not pseudo-random function, but pseudo-random permutations. What are pseudo-random permutations? They are like the function, but permutations. Okay? Exactly the same. What do I mean by that? Rather than consider a function family, I require that the function family I create is a permutation function family. Namely, any member of any function member of the family is, say, permutation from n bits to n bits. Okay, so it's exactly the same definition, but rather I require it to be a permutation ensemble, and not a function ensemble. Okay, exactly the same definition, but I require that the function I create are going to be a permutation. Now there's an important note. Note that I claim that even if f was a pseudo-random function, again, this, let me just go for notation, pi tilde is the set of all permutations from n bits to n bits. I claim that even if f was not a take any pseudo-random function family, no one can distinguish between, with more than negligible probability, between a random member of the function family and the random permutation. Okay, I claim that by definition, no one can distinguish, or almost by definition, between random function family and the set of all possible permutation. Anyone can see why? Because one cannot distinguish between pseudo random permutation, between random permutation and random function. Why? Because if you make small number of queries, you're not going to have collision, and it's impossible to distinguish between random permutation and random family. And therefore, no one can distinguish between random permutation and a pseudo random family. So why should we care then? If pseudo random functions are indistinguishable from random permutation, why should we care about pseudo random permutation? Right? So two answers for that. First, pseudo random permutation give you perfect security in some sense. Namely, some part, you can prove that some part of your primitive is perfectly secure. And more importantly, if you create them correctly, pseudo random permutation are invertible. Okay? Namely, you not only you can find the input that you start with, okay? Given the function, okay? But you can start the input that you start with. Where for pseudo random function, maybe the information theoretically cannot maybe find the input that you start with, because they are function. This information is lost. Okay? So this may be the main reason why you prefer pseudo random permutation for pseudo random function. Okay. And amazingly, even though it looks maybe way more complicated to create pseudo random permutation than pseudo random function, essentially they're equivalent in a sense that you can take any pseudo random function family and convert it into a pseudo random permutation family. Okay? Again, there's a way to take a pseudo random function family and convert it in a pseudo random permutation family. Okay? And how do you do that? Okay? How you convert a function into permutation? Okay? So someone gave you a present of a function and you want to convert it into permutation. Well, clearly you can forget about the function, and just write a permutation. This is a reasonable solution, but then you need to prove that it's pseudo-random, etc. Okay? It's going to be maybe problematic. So now, let me see a strange way to convert a function into permutation. It's called Feistel permutation, Feistel networks. The idea is the following. You're given a function from n bits to n bits. You're going to create a permutation from 2n bits to 2n bits. You're going to define this following. You take the right-hand side, you simply go as the left-hand side of the output. Okay? You take the right-hand side of the input and simply write it as the left-hand side of the output. This seems silly, right? But to compute the right-hand side of the output, you take the right-hand side of the input, compute f on this value, and XOR it with the left-hand side of the output. Again, the easy way to see this by picture, R goes straightly from the right-hand side to the left-hand side. In addition, you compute f on R, XOR it bitwise with the left-hand side, and output it as the new right-hand side. Okay? What good about this construction? The good part is that regardless what f is, it might be map all its input to a single value. The new function is permutation. Anyone sees why?
Because
Right, because you can invert it. You can find, the, given the output, you can find the input. Why? If you get in Z and W, okay? So first, you know the right-hand side of the output. What is the right-hand side of the input? What is the right-hand side of the input? Z, right? Because the left-hand side of the input, the right-hand side of the input went to the left-hand side of the input. So you have half of it. But you also in the second part. Why you have the second part? Because now you can compute f of z, XOR it with this value, and what do you get back? The left-hand side of the output. Again, you are here, you're getting this value. This value you get for free. Okay, nothing happened here. To get this value, when you get here, you can compute this again, f of r, and if you XOR it again with this value, what happens when you XOR twice the same value with the string? You cancel it. Both XOR cancel each other. And therefore, you are left with the original string with L. So this string is a permutation. But not only permutation, it maintains important properties, in a sense that we're going to be clear later, of the original function. Okay? Depends, but if the, in particular, as we see next, if the original function was a pseudo-random function, then the new function, not exactly, going to be pseudo-random permutation. But before that, so let's note that this function is efficient if you're given Oracle access to F. You can compute it efficiently, actually you also can invert it efficiently. But now, you did it once, you can repeat it again, right? You can do again this operation, and again, right? This is why we switch the strange way that we switch the order, okay? And now you can define not LR of F, but LRI of F. It means that you apply not one time, you apply it four times or five times, this operation. You compute, you switch, again, compute, switch, etc., etc. Okay? So we started from what you know now, we started from arbitrary function, we got permutation. Good. Now, we can do the same thing to function family, right? Given the function family, we can define this operation, LRI, not of single function, of the function family, which simply says, takes each function of the family and do this basic operation to this function. Okay? Exactly, simply this set. Go over all functions of the family, each of them convert to permutation using this LR operation. And now comes so know that the function family is always a permutation, and is efficient if the function family is efficient. This is easy to check. So we created a permutation family. Is it pseudo-random? So, is LR1 pseudo-random? Again, F is pseudo-random function family. Okay? Okay? Assume. Is LR1 pseudo-random? Again? Right, it cannot be. Why it cannot be? Because remember LR1? This was F, right? This part of the input simply copied to the output. What is the probability that the left-hand side of the input is copied to the output, to the right-hand side of the output by a random permutation? None, or negligible. What is the probability that it happened by AR1? One. So it's very easy to distinguish. You make my query and see if the right-hand side or the left-hand side of the output equal the right-hand side of the input. If it's yes, you said one. Yes. If it's no, we said no. Okay, so LR1 is definitely not a pseudo-random permutation family, regardless of what f was. What about LR2? Again?
Take LR2 onto your inverted. And if you invert it, you reach the point where you can check invert it again and check whether
you're able to. You're not given access to F. You're not, it's a good point. You don't have access to F. You get access to the generated permutation. You don't have access. If you get access to F, it was very easy. You can invert it. So the answer is also negative, but it's more tricky. Think about any F on the family, regardless of what it is. What happens if computed 0 to the n and 0 to the n? If you follow the definition, so again, you compute it on LR2. If you look what happened in the left-hand side of the output, it's simply F of 0 to the n. Where if you compute LR2 on 1 to the n, 0 to the n, then believe me, it's very easy to check. The left-hand side is going to be F of 0 to the n, XOR 1 to the n. Okay, this holds a very simple distinguisher between a random permutation and this permutation family. What the distinguisher does? It makes these two queries and check if the XOR of them is 1 to the n. What's the probability that it happens if you get a really random permutation family? Basically 2 to the minus n, or very similar to that. What the probability that happens here?
One.
Okay. Okay. What about LR3? Given the time that I have extension of 5 minutes, understand? So the answer is yes, and this is why we call LR. It's not because of left-right, because of Lubi-Rakov. It says that, assuming that F is a pseudo-random function family, then LR3 is pseudo-random permutation family.
I think you need to assume that every round we have an independent F. Same F, it is not.
It is true. What is not true, that if you have in each version queries.
For same F, it is not true. So for all the rounds, 3 rounds, I need to have independent pseudo-random function.
So my proof, you're going to see the proof, or at least the idea. My proof is the non-Abel queries. I'm 99.9% so what is true, and maybe this is what you got confused, is that it's not a permutation family.
So in your definition, you have taken same F.
Right.
But you have to take F1, F2, F3.
Okay.
Independent F. So you just take X and Y, and see the response, and you swap, and you just
Let's bear with me and see if it comes in proof, okay? So what is true, if you do LR4, so it remains, this is in the same way, so on permutation, even if you can, given that you allow inversion queries, you can ask what is the inverse of the permutation. But LR3, and we're going to see it, if you would allow me to see the proof. No, so let's sketch the proof. To stop you? I skipped the proof. Okay. So I'll give you the first, the scheme of this slide, and I'll skip. First, this is an important thing. I claim it suffices to prove that not LR3 of the function family is pseudo-random, but LR3 of the truly random function family. Not of a pseudo-random function family. If the truly random function family is pseudo-random. Anyone can tell me why? Otherwise, you could distinguish between the pseudo-random function family and the truly random function family. How do you do that? You get an element from either the truly random function family or the pseudo-random function family, use it to compute LR free of F, and give it to the distinguisher. So no one can distinguish between LR free of pi of n, LR free of the pseudo-random function family. So now it is left to prove this fact, that this function family, it's inefficient, But given Oracle access to this function family, you cannot distinguish between this function family and pseudo-random function of 2n bits, a truly random function. How do you prove that? Well, we don't have time to prove that. But it's what's good about it is purely, there's no computational issues here, okay? It's a purely combinatorial information theoretical question, okay? By the way, maybe it's simply the same. Maybe LR3 of the all function family is simply equivalent to truly random permutation from n bits to n bits. Turns out it's very different from each other, very different creatures. Both of them are information theoretic, but they're very different creatures. And the reason is, if you think about the truth table of each of them, so the truth table of this family is essentially 2 to the n, but the truth table of the second family is 2 to the 2n. They're very, very different creatures. Still, you can have this claim that no algorithm making at most q queries can distinguish between these two function family but more than q squared over 2 to the n probability. And therefore, if q is polynomial time, or even can be sub-exponential, it cannot distinguish between this function family and this permutation family and this and the set of all random permutations, and therefore you cannot distinguish what we said before between the set of all random permutations to the efficient permutation family you created. So I'm going to skip the proof. Let me summarize. So we constructed PRF and also pseudo-random function and also pseudo-random permutation from less length doubling PRGs, and thus from one-way functions. Main questions, and it's related to what Boaz asked, can you give a more efficient construction of pseudo-random, think about pseudo-random function case from pseudo-random generators? The main issue here, you know, the construction maybe look very concise, but it required n adaptive calls, if you want to compute it as n bits input, n adaptive call to the pseudo-random generator, to consider very highly inefficient, okay? You need to query the pseudo-random generator, and then evaluate it on the output, and evaluate it on the output. Can you give a more efficient construction? Or at least less adaptive construction? Okay, this is the main open question in this field. Okay, so I'm going to end up here.